Hey everyone, welcome to Bumbling Through Dungeons. My name is Mark Wilson. I am a person who talks about this stuff. Today, we're focusing on one of the two of Dungeons & Dragons a little bit more than the other one. And we're focusing on dungeons. And specifically, we're going to talk about Jaquaying a dungeon, which is a word that sort of exists. I don't think it's a real world word, but we're going to talk about it and what it means today. So what Jaquaying a dungeon refers to is a dungeon creator, an adventure writer, by the name of Jennell Jaquays. And I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly. And if I'm not, I apologize profusely, but I couldn't find a definitive pronunciation in my searching, so fingers crossed. But Jennell Jaquays is an adventure creator who became very famous, very popular for a series of adventures and really dungeon design from a number of classic adventures. And I got a lot of these ideas from a wonderful blog on a website called the Alexandrian that some of you may be familiar with, and I'll link to it down in the description. And in that, they do a really deep dive into everything that goes into dungeon creations in Jaquays dungeons. And what this video is about is taking the biggest takeaways from that blog article for me and how I've been able to apply it to my dungeon creations and what it might mean for you and some ideas that you might be able to take away from it as well. So, and I do think it's worth pointing out that when we talk about dungeons, we're not necessarily always talking about underground, subterranean, multi-level, mega dungeons, or things like that. Yes, those are certainly dungeons, and those are very classic dungeons, and a lot of them exist, and they can be very fun, but that isn't the only type of dungeon that I think constitutes a dungeon for Dungeons & Dragons. And I'm really risking saying the word dungeon too many times so that it loses all meaning for me, but we are going to plow forward. But it can also mean a building, a structure, a temple that is multi-level or that has some intricate structure to it. You could be talking about tombs. You could be talking about castles. You could be talking about wizards' towers. There's a lot of things that could be considered dungeons. It's a very broad definition in the D&D sense of the word. And so here we're talking about literally any structure that has form and creation. You know, it could even be natural caves. So that could be the dungeon here as well. But of course, in our game, it's not naturally created. It's created by some DM who wanted to make an interesting adventure and interesting encounters within that location for the players. So how do you make that interesting? And there's a lot, that's too broad a topic, but we're gonna narrow it down a little bit to a couple takeaways here from Jaquays Dungeons. And the biggest thing to me, and we'll unpack this a little bit once I say it, but the biggest thing to me, my biggest takeaway from reading about it and looking at some of these dungeons is that they are non-linear. Now, what does that mean? Well, non-linear, I think we know what linear or non-linear means in a plot sense, and we can probably figure out what it means in a dungeon sense as well, but I think it's worth unpacking the different ways that you can make a dungeon non-linear. So, take a classic video game dungeon like the Diablo games. So you go down, you go down the main staircase into level one of the dungeon, and you kill all the things, and you're searching the dungeon, and there's a bunch of different rooms and monsters and things of that nature, and eventually you find another large staircase, and it leads down into the second level of the dungeon, so on and so on ad infinitum. So I think this was how a lot of dungeons were made, not just in video games. That's one that I'm remembering that's a very classic example. It's also a good example to make this point because I don't think there was ever a time where those dungeons were non-linear. When you were on level one, you could go in various different directions, but then there was really only one staircase to get down to level two. And then from level two, there was only one staircase back up to level one and down to level three. And so in that sense, you went one, two, three, four down into the subterranean levels of the dungeon. It was very linear and it was fun. There's nothing wrong with that. But I think there's some, especially in a D&D game, there are some ways that you can spruce that up a little bit. So the first example, I think, springs from that Diablo example. And frankly, many examples that I've seen in D&D of multi-level dungeons. And that's have different ways up and down and around and through. So if a staircase goes down, maybe it doesn't go down to level 2. Maybe it doesn't go down to level 3 from level 1. Maybe it goes from level 1 to level 5. Maybe there is no way to get to 2, 3, 4 without first going down to level 5. So now they're down on what they might imagine to be the second level, and they go up, and they're not in a place that they recall being in. So now there's going to be a little bit of surprise. They're going to realize that, oh, we're in a more complicated structure than we might have initially realized. And I think at that point, it's going to put them on their guard a little bit and get them thinking about the structure of the location that they're in. And that can only be a good thing when they're applying critical thought to, okay, so how do we navigate this in the best way possible? The other thing that you can do here is that a lot of good Jaquay dungeons didn't necessarily start on level 1. So if you had, again, we're using the classic underground dungeon as an example because it's easy to make these examples. But we'll talk about some examples later that aren't just subterranean. But rather than going down into the tunnel or whatever it is, the cave, into level 1, maybe you have to fly down the side of a cliffside, and the tunnel that gets you into this tomb structure, this intricate labyrinth, starts you on the fifth level down, and there's 3 or 4 levels below it and 4 above it, but the only way to enter or exit is on level 5. That could be something that's a little bit more interesting, because now they have the option of going up or down, and maybe they don't know exactly where their goal is, what they're looking for. They might not know, is it on levels 1 through 4 or 6 through however deep this goes. And that can be another interesting challenge, another interesting decision for the players. So I think in making this non-linear, you're creating decision points for the players of, oh, where are we? What do we want to do about it? How is this different than what's expected? So you're throwing small curveballs at them, but if you throw enough of these ideas at them, it's going to result in something that's markedly more interesting for probably the DM, probably the players, probably everyone at the table. So there are some other related ideas to this. So, okay, you've got the staircase going down from level 1 to level 2, but now maybe it's not level 2 or even a full level. Maybe it's actually just its own little enclave. So you're going down these stairs into this little area, but it's not the only way down, and there's really only a small section here, so it's maybe level 1.5. And there's not much there, you can't get anywhere else, or maybe there's a secret door on level 1.5, and if they find it, they'll go down to level 6. So now they've got access to somewhere new. And you can start to see, you know, I'm throwing a lot of individual examples at you here, but if you're mixing these together and you're including, say, half a dozen of them in a particular larger multi-level dungeon, it's going to create a really interesting environment, and it's going to create a lot of different ways that your players can tackle it. And I think that's one of the points as well. If they feel like there's only one way through all of this, that they're just going to have to deal with everything that you as a DM have come up with, that isn't always as fun for the players. But if they can apply some ingenuity to it, if they can make some decisions about where to go and how to try to navigate this area, and they know that they're not going to see everything, then it'll feel like they have some agency. It'll feel like they have more choice, and that's never bad. So that's almost always going to be a really good thing, to give the players a sense of choice. And it's not just a sense of choice. In this case, a lot of times it really will be a lot of choice. And if there are 2 or 3 different ways to enter a complex, or 2 or 3 ways to get out, or 2 or 3 ways to find your way to a particular level, ha, I can say that, then however they get there is going to be their way, and it's going to feel more personal, and it's going to feel cooler to them. And it'll probably be more fun for you as a DM, because you won't be sure what they're going to do, and there's a lot of fun to be had there. So now I want to start talking about this in the sense of other types of structures. And we're eventually going to shrink it down. In all the examples that I gave you earlier, it was pretty much a mega dungeon. You know, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 levels of some mega dungeon. And we're talking about the different levels. You can do this on a smaller scale. We're going to talk about a couple ways to do that, because I think that a lot of encounters, hell, a lot of campaigns that I run will never have a single mega dungeon that has 5 or more levels to it. that isn't a style of game that I often run. So I think the most that I've done is maybe three or four levels. I don't know that I've ever truly run something that might be considered a mega dungeon, but I've still been able to apply a lot of these concepts to the dungeons that I've run, and I've had a lot of fun with it. So instead of underground, let's go above ground. And there's a ziggurat, and the ruler of the city lives in this massive ziggurat, and it is labyrinthine, and maybe there are literal dungeons on the lowest levels, but then, you know, servants' quarters and banquet halls and bathhouses and throne room and all sorts of other whatever else you can think up of in this structure. But it might be very labyrinthine. There's going to be multiple levels, and I'm guessing that there's ways to get from one level to another that isn't directly adjacent to it. And I think it's going to be more fun if you do that as well. So how do you navigate something like that if you're entering on level one? So if you don't have any means of starting off on the higher levels, but say the players do, say they are able to wrangle a griffin, or they have some flight spells or whatever, and they have a chance to go and try to enter on a higher level, what options do they have to do that? Could they fly up to the top and enter there? What would that look like? What would the new challenges be that they have, you know, opportunities, but also challenges that they have available up there on those other levels? So I think thinking through this is going to give them a bunch of different options, a bunch of different ways to do it. I think there is some psychology at play here. I'm not a psychologist, so I don't know the exact principles or things like that, but if you take another, I haven't played video games in years, so all my video game references are going to be older ones, but if you take a game like Deus Ex, which was well regarded for its time, and I think it still is, one of the things that it pioneered that a lot of games after it copied was it would present you with, okay, here's the big evil structure that we have to infiltrate, and then we have to do this thing inside the fortress. And of course it was futuristic dystopia, so we weren't talking about fantasy so much like in D&D most of the time. It was a very different genre, but you could augment your person to go in guns a-blazing and take everyone out and enter the complex that way. You could find some sneaky way of like entering the ventilation ducts, or you could hack the cameras and use them to create a distraction somewhere else that allowed you to sneak in and use the enemy's mechanical turrets against them, something like that. So there were usually at least three different ways to tackle a problem. And usually if it gave you a big old skyscraper to enter or building, there was usually at least two ways to get in, usually more. And I think a lot of the same principles that we're talking about here were evident in a game like that, and in a lot of good games since then that have copied that style. It's going to be more satisfying when the players can solve it their way. And if you give them enough options, they might even find ways that you're not expecting, or ways to combine the elements that you've created in ways that you're not expecting. And I think that's some of the most fun that you can have in D&D, is those moments where you don't know what's going to happen and you're having to react to it and you're collaborating on that story together. So we've now talked about above ground structures, but we've still only talked about very large multi-level structures. So what if you've just got a house, a building, a warehouse? How do you do this for something that's a lot smaller? Well, what are the options for getting in? Are there windows? Maybe they could sneak in the windows. Are the windows unlocked? What level? What story? Is it a two-story warehouse? Where will they be coming in? Will it be in an office? Will it be in the main warehouse? Could they just walk in the front door? Could they kick the door down and just initiate combat? And then you can start to think creatively about different ways that you might set up even smaller encounters or smaller locations like this. Maybe there's a skylight. Maybe there's no ceiling over a particular portion. So if they're able to scale up to the roof, they have another option where now they have the height advantage over whoever's in the warehouse. Maybe they're just sneaking into the warehouse. Who knows? Maybe there's no actual enemies in there. But, you know, they could then lower a rope and climb down into the warehouse rather than having to kick down the door. So here, again, we've got maybe one, two, three rooms tops. We're nowhere near a mega dungeon. We're not even at a multi-level dungeon, but we're at a dungeon of 1 to 5 rooms, and there are two or three maybe four different ways that we've discussed that they might be able to get into this place. Now, something like a warehouse, probably not going to be too hard to enter, but how they enter might matter. Say someone has a hostage inside the warehouse. Well, now how they enter really matters because something could happen to the hostage. So maybe they can't just kick down the door and take out whoever's inside because they have that leverage. So it's going to change depending on the circumstance, depending on the plot hook, depending on the challenge and encounter that you have planned. But there are ways that you can do this on a very small level to make things that aren't linear. One of the earliest sessions I ever ran as a DM, it was pretty obvious that I was doing this. And I got better at it as a DM as time went on. But they had to infiltrate. It was a fort. And so it was well fortified. It was like a mercenary company's fort. And I gave them three options through NPC allies of how they might be able to get in. And the first was like, oh, there's a shipment of goods that comes in and out every day, so we'll hide you in the barrels. Okay, so there's the first one. The second one was there are sewers underneath. There might be a way in through the sewers. So the sewers was the second. And then they had access to some griffins. I think I alluded to that earlier. So they had some griffins. And I said, and this is going to be dangerous, but we could airdrop you with parachutes from the griffins. And of course, because it's D&D, they chose the airdrop from the griffins. But it was me saying, okay, here's A, B, or C so that you have some choice in the matter. I was too heavy-handed about it in saying, here are your three options, because I basically laid it out for them rather than leaving ways for them to figure out that those were the three ways, or just leaving clues like, oh, there's a shipment that comes in and out every day, and letting them piece that together if they wanted to, say, hide in the barrels, or dropping clues about the sewer system so that they might think, oh, maybe we can get underneath it and come up from the sewers into the location. There are ways you can do that that are a little bit more subtle that don't require you saying, well, here's your three options, choose between them. But I think I still had this same sort of choice, this same sort of player agency at heart. That's what I was going for. And I wasn't a good enough DM at the time to make it work as well as I wanted. But in subsequent years, since that early session, I've found other ways to incorporate some of those same ideas in subtler ways that really do give the players a lot of choices, either ones that I'm thinking of or maybe sometimes even ones that I haven't thought of. So there it is, Jaquaying a dungeon. I'm really horrible about, I record these well in advance, so I'm really horrible about when they go live, remembering to put the links in the description. So if you're watching this and the links that I said aren't in the description, and that's to my blog post on Jaquaying and also the much longer and much more in-depth post or posts, plural, from the Alexandrian on Jaquaying a dungeon. If those aren't in the description, please let me know. I'll remember eventually, even if they're not up immediately. But I hope this video has given you some ideas about this concept that you can bring into your own game in ways that are going to make your dungeons, both big and small, seem a little bit more interesting, both for you and for your players. But otherwise, have a good week. We'll see you in the next one. Till then, take care.